Right. Well, thank you for joining us this afternoon as part of Armory Live. My name is Jen Mergel, and I'm going to be moderating the discussion. A little bit about me, so you know who I am and why I'm sitting here with these esteemed artists. I am the curator of the platform section. Those are the large-scale, site-responsive installations throughout the fair. And in my life outside of working in with the Armory Show this past week, I've most recently been a senior curator of contemporary art at the Museum of Fine Arts, as well as prior to that, the Institute of Contemporary Art, and have developed commissions and first-time exhibitions and large-scale surveys of artists who are really attuned to materiality and to how materials can evoke meaning and different connotations, and artists who are responsive to sight. So folks that I've worked with in the past include Nicholas Huobo, Tara Donovan, Liliana Porter, Shanique Smith, Daniela Rivera, upcoming Fujiko Nakaya. Today, I am very honored to moderate an artist dialogue, and this is between two exceptional artists who are just meeting. Leonardo Drew and Jatavia Gary. Leo is known for his sculptural installations that are very dynamic and responsive to sight. Jatavia is known for very profound short films and animations. And my role here is to prompt an exchange that might reveal new insights on their distinctive practices by comparison. We're going to discuss their making with some visuals as well, and then I will leave time for questions from the audience. And before we dive right in, I do want to give some brief introductions because both of these artists have many accolades that you should know of. So I always start with the work. So for Leo, people can see your monumental installation, number 123X. Just up that flight of stairs, I guess if you wait in that long line to head up. It's currently on view here in Pier 92, and it's presented by Rosenfeld Porcini, thank you, Ian, of London. The piece spans over 30 feet, over a dozen now about 14 feet high, and it is representative of your decades of making in many ways, and then is an interesting jumping off point into some new directions, I think. It is created out of like hundreds of remnants, I'm using that as air quotes, and we can talk about that a little bit more, of wood, metal, fabric, pigment, and you accrue these into very rhythmic and dynamic compositions. I think that's safe. We're going to talk a little bit about like where you're coming from and things that you've done in the past. I just, again, very accomplished artist, born in 1961 in Tallahassee, Florida. Moved up to New York in the 80s, went to Parsons. You got your BFA from Cooper Union. And then you've shown at a number of museums. You know, I can't name them all, but yes, the Hirshhorn, the Smithsonian, Art Institute of Chicago, major survey exhibition, traveled to three venues across the U.S., including the DeCordova and Lincoln, Mass., and recently the DeYoung Museum in San Francisco and Crystal Bridges. So you've been around the block. Yep. Jatavia. I want people to know that you can see your amazing work, including a piece you'll be showing today, the Ecstatic Experience, on view at the Whitney Museum of American Art in the exhibition, An Incomplete History of Protest. You were born in Dallas in 1984. You're also currently based here. You're both based in Brooklyn. Are you next door neighbors? No.
I live in Bed-Stuy.
Yeah, we are.
You are. So you've beautifully described the role your film plays in, quote, charting the various ways raced and gendered bodies navigate popular media. You earned your MFA in social documentary filmmaking here in New York, and you are co-founder of the New Negress Film Society. I can't tell you all of the places where Jatavia's films have been screened, but festivals, including Edinburgh, New Voices in Black Cinema, Toronto Inside Out Festival, Black Star Festival, and in really significant venues like the Schomburg Center for Research in Black Culture, NYU Florence, Museum of Contemporary Art Los Angeles, ICA Boston, as well as MoMA PS1. And I do want to, like, there's an elephant in the room. Like, why is it that when I was asked as the curator of Platform, okay, would you like to have a conversation with one of the artists in Platform? I said, I want to talk with this guy. And I said, you know, it would be really exciting if you were in dialogue with somebody, amazing practitioner, but actually coming from a different direction, maybe different generation, but also different medium. So we have a filmmaker on stage as well, working at the animation, working with amazing material. But I was interested in talking with you both about, and these are our bullet points for the day, we'll sort of circle around and reference these ideas, materiality in your respective practices. There's a patina of history in a lot of the materials that you both work with. How it is that you make the edit. The edit is very important. What you choose to put in and what you choose to leave out of your works. And larger questions about texture, how you work texture into your pieces individually. And we'll get into questions of process as well. But I hope, Leo, you'll start us off with process. We have a few slides of your work that we can begin running. And I'd love to give, here's Leo. He had his first exhibition at age 13, is that right? Yeah. Can you talk with us a little bit about your process? Because there's a beautiful catalog that came out last year by Contemporary Art Museum Raleigh called Journal, right? And you were very generous in this book. You showed us your list.
I don't know. Let me get right to it. Hold on.
It's warm up here, right?
You know, when it comes to the reason why that book got going was that there are people who have been following the work, mm-hmm. and they realized that there was a book that you could have gotten online, but it had gotten so difficult to get that. Maybe $2,000 to get it online. So yeah. I was like, okay, it's time to give people who can really appreciate and have joined me on this journey something back.
Yeah.
So it was a matter of 2 years of me actually getting through all of my material, my photographs, my notes, which is what you're getting to, you're coming to. It's just like, give them everything. Let them know what it's like to actually be in the studio every day.
Yep.
What your daily routine is, how you come to conclusions about how you're sort of dragged in to the day. They should know about all those things.
Yeah.
And so that book is that. So it's I call it a book for geeks, knuckleheads, and artists. So,
geeks, knuckleheads, yes. And artists. Okay. Well,
it's an easy read for people who are really serious about the practice.
Yes. Well, and the practice. Mm. The practice is what I'd love to talk about. So you're seeing various examples of Leo's work on screen right now, from different time periods, different media. But there is something beautiful you included in that book, which was a list of about 12, 13 different things you wanted to accomplish in a day. And you started off, it's a handwritten list, with repair the hole in my studio pants. And then number two was, I need to glue my sneaker. And then you cross it out, get new sneakers, right? And then you keep going to very specific processes, like soak the cotton in a rust bath for, X number of minutes. Okay, drop the strings over the 5-gallon buckets. Let's gather the remnants of wood and sift through those for pieces that are about 4 by 4 inches, right? And you run through this long list in your process, right? And I wonder, as people are looking at pieces like this on screen, can you tell people about the sourcing of your materials? And I'm going to use this, how you organize them in the studio?
Well, I always call it, studios like You know, you're the, you know, this is a sea of chaos, and you are the island in the sea of chaos. And you have to make sense of all this.
Yeah.
And you have to survive it also, because there's a lot of energy that's poured into something that it could be actually a failure. Though I wouldn't actually call any of this stuff failures, because it's in the end, you take them and you turn them into something else. So there's always the opportunity to for these things to sort of like have these layered existence.
Yep.
So the life of these parts, we'll call them parts, that come together to make a life.
Yep.
And so I think it's important to sort of to live with this material.
Right.
So that list actually is sort of like a I guess a menu, or you know, I'm like, well, that's me and the cotton.
Yep. Yep. Moving that bale of cotton a couple dozen blocks. Yes. From green sheets down the street.
30-something blocks.
Yep.
On a dolly.
Yep. Yep.
I didn't drive then, and it's like it was just a matter of getting that material to you know, from point A to point B.
Mm-hmm.
To create, you know, something that may not, like I said, may not be successful, but it's not so much really for me about the final product. It's more about the journey.
Right.
Hence the title, Journal.
Yep.
And as I sort of go through this life, you know, right now I'm spending a lot of time in China and working with the Masters of Porcelain. I mean, the history of that material has the beginnings there.
Mm-hmm.
Being one of the cradles of civilization, you want to be sort of like an antenna. You want to plant yourself like an antenna and receive information of that place.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm, you know, like I move around different parts of the world just to sort of take in.
Yep. Yep.
And then as an artist, you have the opportunity to give that back. So it's it's a living.
It's a living. So you you're working with materials that often have when I use this word patina, right? That have some history. You sometimes lend texture to the materials, and sometimes I know when I visited you in your studio, you described. You were grabbing like tree trunks and fallen trees from the nearby cemetery, you know, nearby. And so sometimes these materials have lived a long life already, and you're continuing them on their journey. And other times, like, you'll deliberately, progressively rust pieces of metal or move fabrics. In this case, your beautiful piece was the sharing the stage with Merce Cunningham Dance Company, right? So your materials may have one life in a gallery and then another life on stage.
Absolutely.
And sometimes you may take a piece that's installed in one place, and then it may be broken down and become elements in another piece. If we don't mind, I want to flip here, and Chitavi, I'm going to put you in the spotlight for a second to follow up on this idea of working with materials that have had a prior life. And I would like us, if we can, I'm looking at the booth, see if we can't flip over to share a short piece by Jatavia. This is actually on view now in the city. Six minutes and 11 seconds. But you're gonna get a sense of material that's had a prior life. You're involved with it texturally, and you're bringing it into the present.
Mm-hmm.
Would you like to say anything more about this clip before we show it, or about the piece before we show it?
I was just wondering if we can dim the lights or not. Yeah. But the piece is, I think it was from 2015, mm-hmm. and you're right, I am gathering materials from the past, lots of archival material, and imprinting my own response onto it, whether through direct animation techniques such as etching and scratching directly onto the emulsion of the film, or removing the emulsion completely to the point where it's a clear canvas, and I'm just painting directly onto the celluloid, but then bringing it into the editing system and cutting it, editing it with contemporary footage.
Mm-hmm.
So there's this kind of conversation happening.
Perfect. Can we run the film?
Thank you. mother had 12 of us children, and it troubled her in our heart, you know, the way we was treated. And she'd pray every night to the Lord to get her and her children off that place. Well, one day she was plowing in the field, and all of a sudden, she let out a big yell and started singing and shouting and whooping and hollering. And Master Jim came running and he says, "What's all this going on out in the field? You think I sent you out here just to hoop and yell? No, sirree. I sent you out here to work. And you better work or I'll put this cowhide across your black back." And my mama, she just smiled all over her face. And she said, "Lord has showed me the way. I ain't gonna grieve no more. No matter how you all done treat me and my children, the Lord has showed me the way. And someday, we ain't gonna never be slaves no more." And old Master Jim took that bull whip and started lashing Mama across her back. But she didn't say nothing. She just got up, went on back to the field, a singing and a shouting. "I'm free. I'm free. I'm free. I'm free."
I decided.
You decided?
Yeah, it was time.
It was time.
To escape. To try to escape. That's what I did. It was a clean escape. No one was hurt. I planned it as well as I could plan it. And that's all I gotta say about it.
Have seen the glory of the coming of the Lord. He is trampling out the vintage where the grapes of wrath are stored. He hath loosed the faithful lightning of his terrible swift sword. His truth is marching on. Glory, glory, hallelujah.
So, Chitavi, I want to start by actually sharing your own words with you that you had shared to the world just last month. I was reading your Instagram account, and you made this beautiful post, right? And so forgive me, but I'm just going to share these words, and then I would love to get your thoughts on how it plays out in an ecstatic experience. So, Chitavi had written, quote, "So grateful to have a film practice that allots for several hours of meticulous work with my hands. I find this time disconnected from digital media and electronic hardware allows me room to daydream and ruminate on both the very whimsical and gravely serious aspects of my work." This contemplation, coupled with repetitive and seemingly mindless women's work, is pivotal for the formation and sharpening of a subjective and highly critical Black feminist lens, which undergirds much of my creative practice, allowing me the mind space and time to meander freely is also key in quelling the near constant pulse of anxiety housed within. Not simply a tool for personal economic growth or personal aggrandizement, the work is a soothing balm. And I keep coming back to how that comes out of a practice based on meticulous work with your hands.
Yeah, I'm really grateful for it because, you know, like most of the people my age, I'm constantly scrolling, it seems like, and it's driving this kind of anxiety that's coupled with just like the anxiety that comes with being a Black person in America, it feels like. And I was really blessed in a graduate school to visit the studio of Simone Lee. I reached out to her, and I made a kind of mediocre film about her excellent process. But while talking to her, I was kind of put on. She like really educated me about this notion of women's work, this notion of gendered labor, and how she incorporates it into her practice. And so I have to tip my hat to her because she's really the first person who got me to think about how labor is so stratified across gender and how I could use this, right? But yeah, the meticulous scratching and the painting, like the Ruby Dee portion of that film, that's about 2 minutes. But it took about 2 months to do, because there's 24 frames per second, and I'm manipulating each frame. So I'm going through, and sometimes I'm planning things out. I say, I want 52 frames of a square box around her head, or I want, you know, 30 frames of a halo around her head. Or sometimes I'm just completely letting it rip. It's improvisational. So it's not always so structured. Oftentimes it's just me kind of responding to what I see on the celluloid. So I'll find some film that I like. I'll look at it. I'll watch it on my projector at home. I'll stop the projector if something catches my eye. And I'll cut, right? I'll take just like a clip, just like one might do with digitally, right, in Avid or Final Cut Pro or Premiere, whatever your editing software is. You pull a select and you keep that select for later. And I was watching your Art 21, and you were talking about how some fragments of work, you'll work on them and then you'll sit them to the side, and then you'll come back and you'll realize, oh, this actually goes with that. We can stick that there. And this film was very much like the process of making this film was very much like that. That first montage point where they're in the church and you hear the Alice Coltrane, I feel like I made that in 2014. I was still in grad school and I'm thinking, you know, I'm tired of doing observational verite cinema. I want to do some really weird shit, and like, let's really dig deep and try to make a montage, right? Yep. And I did it, and my teachers were like, yeah, whatever, that's cute. So I just stashed it, you know, on my hard drive. But then I came back to it after I had etched Ruby Dee, after I had done all the illustrations and that kind of emotional response. It's basically what it is. It's an emotional response to what she's saying it, but I'm doing it. I'm responding in an impressionistic way directly onto the celluloid. So once I finished that, and I think, oh, wow, maybe I can merge these two somehow. Because the concept of the film was, well, the goal of the film was, can I make a film without a story? Can I make a film centered around a concept or a notion or an idea? And that's pushing directly against what I learned in film school. But I wanted to try that. I wanted to experiment with that. And I think by de-emphasizing story, it gives me a space to think more broadly and conceptually instead of worrying about simply representing them. Because, you know, Blackness is multivalent, and I'm very interested in representing, you know, the nuances of Blackness. But I'm also interested in having the audience member position themselves to what they're seeing. And have to do that through a sort of critical distance. So I'm less interested in A, B, and C of a story, and more so about these kind of overarching concepts.
Yeah. What do you think about this notion of the value of setting aside, of taking something, working with it, and then letting it have some space to, I'm going to call it, stew, right? Let the juices and let the marrow get really rich.
I guess I had alluded to that earlier, that the longer you allow material to be around, the more it can collect information. As many lives as this material that you've touched, you know, many times you've touched it, it has actually that much more, you know, like a opportunity to have a real live existence. So in that, once you bring it back into the fold, so to speak, it only layers and becomes actually a full-on life, you know. So I do understand these processes because they are natural processes. Mm-hmm. You know, we're not separate from nature. I mean, it's like we are actually, you know, we are. So if we align ourselves with that philosophy, that life actually is something that is, you know, that lives through all things, you know, we are not separate from nature. We are part of it. So film, all these are actually a film, from film to the other visual arts, you know, like all these things, even music, all these things are a part of a larger cosmic reality. Mm-hmm. You know, I've been following film, you know, like pretty much all my life. I mean, my biggest influence have been, you know, like when I was young, just going to the museums was not really an option. Mm-hmm. So, you know, like following film, especially like things like on the PBS programs, I mean, they had a lot of foreign films, and you had an opportunity to realize that there are other things going on outside of your existence, you know. Following, you know, that format, that is still a big part of how I see things visually. You would know it from the compositions, you know, like, or at least the visuals that I give you. But in the end, that's what I use as a template to sort of realize things, the weight.
I think I would know it. I think I would. When Jen told me that Leonardo's a big film buff, it was very clear. when you're thinking about composition and the grid, that's something that, you know, filmmakers, specifically cinematographers, but not just cinematographers, directors as well, are always thinking about, you know. But what's exciting, who says what's exciting about my work? What's exciting about my work is there are many ways to elicit a response, right? And it's through this kind of compositional setup, but also thinking about the edit, right? Thinking about what you can place next to something to have some sort of emotional or intellectual response, right? So this kind of, John and Comfort would say, and Arthur Jaffo, they would both say effective proximity. But, you know, the Soviets would say the Khrushchev effect, or, you know, Eisenstein, they're thinking about...
Right. Soviet filmmakers would say.
Yes, Soviet filmmakers, sorry, that sounds not in this climate, right? the Soviet filmmakers would talk about these kind of montage experiments and what it means to put one image in the frame of something next to another one that may seemingly be disparate, right? And have some sort of response, this dialectical materialism. You take one thing and you take another thing and they meet and something else occurs, a new meaning occurs. Mm-hmm. So yeah, that's what I'm doing. And I feel like that's also what you're doing in a really interesting way.
Well, you know, I worked with, did this project with Merce Cunningham some years back, and like, he uses a formula very similar to Stanley Kubrick, which is you have these three sections mm-hmm. that you work on,
yep.
and then you bring them together at some point. Mm-hmm. But you work on them and fine tune them, and then once they've actually reached a certain point, it's time to bring these elements together. Now Merce would actually take the choreography, of course, the phrasing. He would do that. He brought me in as the artist, you know, to do my thing, and then the musician did his thing, all separate from one another. So I never knew what he was doing. Mm-hmm. The musician didn't know what either of us were doing. But opening night, curtains would go up, and that was the first time. That was his formula. Mm-hmm. You know, all these elements would come together. And I asked him, I said, what happens if it doesn't work? He said, well, then it's move on to the next project. But in the end, this is a trust. At the same time, if you've lived like we were saying with the materials long enough, I mean, Mercer is a master. And it's obviously Stanley Kubrick is that also. So having, you know, like putting this in the hands of someone who can't orchestrate, you know, you can breathe life into something that was like actually a second ago was like nothing, you know.
Yep. Yeah. Could we talk about this idea of kind of the juxtapositions that could have some friction to them or also defying expectations, right? So, if you're talking about music, you're talking about how Merce Cunningham, choreographer, amazing dance performances, might compose an overall effect or overall experience between the visuals on stage, like your sculptural pieces and the dancer's movement and the music. Sometimes defying expectations can be an act of resistance. You can have music that's discordant or that's beautifully choral. Right, and both can register a strong emotional response. So, if you're thinking about the way you compose, and I'd love to talk on that formal level, how do you make decisions about what to put next to the say next frame or next physical piece that is going to give you the energy or the register you want? Either it's expected or it's unexpected. And I guess I'll have you, Jatavi, I'll have you start. Either thinking about the piece we just saw, or if we feel we can also shift over to your second piece.
Yeah, I generally have some sense of what I want to go into a film, especially films like this. Like I'm making a documentary that's a pretty normal, well, no, it's not, but it has its conventional documentary traditions. But these pieces are very much these kind of encapsulated moments, I feel like, or these impressionistic, you know, flashes, I guess. And I usually have some idea of what I want them to be constituted by, right? But I don't usually know how I'm going to situate them until I begin to bring things into the Avid, right? The editing software that I use. And to your earlier point, I've usually worked on things, you know, small nuggets a bit, you know, they've taken on some sort of shape or form, and then I bring them into the space. And then oftentimes there's music that is this kind of cohesive thread that's bringing everything together, right, or separating things, right? So in the next piece that we'll see, music is this kind of deciding element. It shows you where we are, it disrupts. But it also holds things together. So oftentimes I'm following this kind of rhythmic setup or framework, or it's oftentimes very intuitive. Yep. You know, so I'm looking and then I'm responding to what I see on the timeline.
Yep. Well, I think we should look at Giverny 1. If we can cue that up, we're not going to see the entire piece. We're going to see just a quick introductory segment. Mm-hmm. Do you want to say anything else in relation to what you're just talking about with this piece?
No.
Okay, let's look first. Okay.
Boyfriend just went like that.
Keep your hands where they are, please.
Yes, I will, sir. I'll keep my hands where they are. Please don't tell me this, Lord. Please just don't tell me that he's gone.
Let me see your hands. Exit now. Keep them up. up. Keep them up.
Face Where's my daughter? You got my daughter?
Face away from me and walk backwards. Walk backwards towards me. Keep walking. Backwards. Keep walking. Keep walking. Keep walking. Get on your knees. Get on your knees.
There's a bird in here.
There are a few birds in here. Yes. Speaking of Giverny.
Yeah. So that I was in France. I was really blessed. My first artist residency was at the Monet Foundation at Terra mm-hmm. Summer Residency, and they put you in this really beautiful setting, and it was kind of a mind fuck. I'm gonna be honest. It was like, what is this? You know, it's a really beautiful space. But I was destabilized in this space because I was connected to social media. And at the time, it was a really bloody summer.
Yeah.
There was a lot of murder happening. So I felt kind of ethically torn being in this space. Working class, black lady from the American South. So, you know, really politically minded as much as I try to tune things out. So I felt like I had to respond in some way, and I felt like my mind, you know, this notion of Du Boisian double conscious, it felt like it was fragmented even more, like there was a quadruple conscious, and I could see myself from all of these different vantage points. And I feel like I was losing it a little bit in the middle of a beautiful garden. So I wanted to kind of respond to that space and respond to, you know, what was happening and to kind of, again, impress upon. I feel like my work is a kind of like a psychological and emotional space made manifest, like made visible for people to have to deal with. You know, it's not comfortable work. It usually sucks the air out of the room, but I feel like it's necessary in some way. And with this, it was me. I knew that I wanted to have me in the space. I knew I wanted to film myself in the space. And I knew I wanted this woman, Diamond Reynolds, who was recording her boyfriend, Philando Castile's death. She wanted to have some sort of record of it, of course, you know, so an act of surveillance to kind of keep the record, keep the time. So I knew I had these two elements. And what you're hearing is a kind of chopped and screwed version of Louis Armstrong's La Vie en Rose. I had another Texas artist kind of slow this down. Chopping and screwing is a way of, it's a hip hop. Google it. Anyway, so we slowed this down. And I knew I wanted to think about rupturing,
yep.
Interrupting. Destabilizing a very serene and kind of calm space repeatedly. So it's about that loop. And she begins to break down the Negress character who I play. It's called Giverny One Negress Imperiale. So she begins to break down over time. She's trying to hold herself in a very respectable way and perform a certain style of respectability and dignity, but under duress. So I'm trying to make some connections between myself or the character I'm playing and the woman who is living this waking nightmare of having her loved one gunned down in front of her.
Yeah. And I know that you you screened the piece also at MoMA, mm-hmm. like on a Monday night at MoMA. And I'm thinking about maybe some of the expectations, again, in defying expectations when it comes to MoMA, the seat of modernism, you know, in New York or in the U.S., you know, we can have that longer conversation. You have little clips also of, you know, you have Monet and little snippets of him mm-hmm. also kind of at the canvas. And there are all of these discussions about how in the 1880s, there, you know, the reason they're called Impressionists is because they were breaking down this clear, you know, window view, this clear picture of how things are, and then actually showing it via energy, showing it via light bouncing off of things, showing the change of the times, the speed of the railroad coming in, or the steam, or the smoke, or the fracturing. Mm-hmm. Right? And it's very interesting to me that I think of your works as dealing with fracturing in many different ways. And so that is a starting point, while the garden itself for you is calm, mm-hmm. and there's this dissonance between what was happening back at home in the United States. Even what you were starting with, I guess art historically could be considered sort of a fracturing or breaking down, and you're breaking it down in this moment much further. I wonder if we can flip back to Leo's works for just a second and keep scrolling forward, and maybe just stop right here. Like this is you in your studio, Leo?
Is that what you call it? Island of Sanity and Sea of Chaos?
Yeah, Sea of Chaos.
But, you know, like, this is, it's like everyday life.
Forgive me for saying so. I normally would never do this as a curator, but I feel like there's a quote of yours that you've shared in an interview that I feel like could have an emotional register as well, and you can say, nope, not what I was thinking, Jen. Like, denied, wrong. but you've communicated in a few ways, and this is a quote you've shared. I've been living with these things long enough to realize it's about layers. The longer they hang out, the deeper the history, the richer the life, right? And that's such an amazing image. You're not just, you know, these things aren't filed away. Like, I know you have an amazing shelving system and organization system as well.
You wouldn't know it from that photograph.
But you're living with these things, right?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And so this is the part where I'm going to beg your indulgence for a second. When I read that sentence and think about what you just said, Jatavia, like, I'm here in France, but I'm living with these things, right? I can't shut down. I can't ignore what is happening, say, across the Atlantic while I'm over here in France. Leo, when you say I'm living with these things long enough to realize it's about layers, do you think about that also on, say, a personal, social, emotional level?
Well, I mean, when I say things, I mean, that's all encompassing. It's not, it has very little to do with the actual object.
Yeah.
Objects are transitory. So when it comes to, you know, like how you navigate through the self and then how that comes out, all these experiences and all the things that you've, all the things that you've taken on and that you now have to process and now give back. I mean, that's what I'm talking about.
Yeah.
It's not really about the physical, but actually about something more, far more spiritual and philosophical.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. I think I'm only speaking for myself, but I think many people in the room who know your work and respond to your work actually feel that also. It's not just about the things. It's not inanimate. Mm. And I'd like to get us to the point. I know we're...
One thing, though.
Yeah.
This idea that you are the center, that you as the artist are the all-knowing. Yeah. I mean, I always like to dispel that idea because... You know, creating is one thing, but the viewer actually is complicit. Mm-hmm. I mean, in completing the work, you have to have that.
Yeah.
You know, creating in a vacuum is like going nowhere. It's like going in circles. So the idea of the artist having all the answers, I'm going to tell you that is absolutely not true.
Yeah.
You know, I need you actually on the other side of that to pull it through,
right.
You know? It's about all of us, really. It's a mirror. So that's what the work is, like this. Hold up a mirror, you know? It's very little to do with, like, you know, you don't really have to know what I've been through in order to know what's going on in that, mm-hmm. you know? Mm-hmm. It's not necessary.
Mm-hmm. Right?
That's why I number the works,
yep.
you know?
Yep.
And not titled, yeah.
Right. Like the piece upstairs is titled 123X, mm-hmm. and you're not giving a sense of narrative. Mm-hmm. You're kind of, like you said, you know, you're giving an impression. Like you're resisting narrative and some of the, having come out of documentary and story form, mm-hmm. this impression. And I wanna get us to the point where in our last 10 minutes or so of an idea of this, we're gonna get a little bit more abstract, right? But of energy, right? You talk about an ecstatic experience, right? In that earlier piece. I guess in a way, like we could talk about, you know, there could be tension, right? That's one type of energy. These things, you know, logically don't seem, maybe in edit cuts, you're jumping back and forth in terms of emotional registers, back and forth in material registers, right? But you can have an energy that's sort of, as I was saying, discordant or choral. You could have something that's cathartic, right? Like a sense of catharsis or release. Maybe this would actually be a good time to show the last clip of the same piece we were just looking at, Giverny 1, because I feel like the idea of these pieces potentially being a mirror to a moment and us completing them, in some case, it can either hold tension in and let us sit with that, or it's sort of a sense of release or expansion. And so I know that's getting a little bit formal, a little bit more abstract, but I'd love to look at this last piece and then talk about this idea of mirroring something bigger and letting things out into the world. So this is the second clip later on in Jatobia's piece.
He let the officer know before he was breaching that he had a firearm on him. Before he can let the officer know anything, the officer took off shot. About 4 or 5 rounds of shot. I don't know what condition he's in. If he's okay or if he's not okay.
So I specifically, in dialogue back and forth with Jatavia, I said, you know, I loved that first clip of this piece, thinking about
the intercutting,
the intercuts, and the juxtaposition of, say, an expectation of calm, mm-hmm. rejuvenation out in nature, and then the clip back and forth, mm-hmm. Documenting Philando Castile's death. And the point where there was the instruction from the police officer to walk backwards, and then in your own footage of you in the garden, you're walking backwards. But I had said, I'm hopeful we can also share that moment of the scream. Mm. And if you could just talk a little bit about your decision and your thoughts about that in the moment, in the space, and also in editing that in to the piece.
So we had the opportunity to go into the space when there was no one there, when it was empty. Because usually there's thousands of people trafficking in and out of that space daily. It's like a tourist spot. But at 6 o'clock, everybody leaves. And so I didn't go in there when there was mad people in there because I don't need an anxiety attack. But I went in there when it was empty. And it is a space that literally begs for disruption. Mm-hmm. To me, it did, you know, like it seemed very beautiful and serene, but it also felt like you just wanted to go and you wanted to run through it or you wanted to hop in the pond. This was my impulse, right, to disrupt this space. So I knew at some point I was going to film myself screaming in the garden, yes. whether it was sanctioned or not. We were going to go in there guerrilla style with the camera and capture ourselves, you know, position myself in a certain spot and scream in the garden. Because I had been looking at a bunch of text that showed models, you know, lying very serenely and who were painted, right, whose image was captured. And I wanted to kind of be this kind of unruly political black body in this space. Just my very image there is a disruption. So I wanted to capture that. And throughout the film, you see me attempting to scream, but it's trapped. You don't hear anything. And at the very end, things begin to build and build and build, and then this scream occurs. So the two worlds, the Diamond Reynolds and myself, they begin to merge, mm-hmm. right? So we're no longer stopping the music and going into this kind of police surveillance footage. They begin to just kind of overlap. So what becomes discordant, what was once discordant, is now just like a piece of each other. They're together now. Mm-hmm. Because we're thinking about not the distinction between myself and a Diamond Reynolds, but the overlap. Right. This negress is in this garden, but at any moment she could be victim to arbitrary and gratuitous violence, right? At any moment anything can happen. Just because you have proximity to power, proximity to money and luxury, that doesn't mean that, you know, there's a safety is there. So that's the breaking down of these two distinct worlds and kind of merging them as two. And so the scream is her finally, you know, this ultimate transgression. She's smoking and nude at one point. She's running back and forth. She's transgressing the space, mm-hmm. While still trying to hold it together. At the very end, though, it's this moment of eruption.
Yeah. And also very calm and erect walking off of the bridge after that release, right? So it almost seemed like there was never, I'm never going to call it actually a loss of composure. I'm going to call it actually like a connection to the core. Mm. And then her core is upright again and she walks right off. And so... there's something about that release in this piece, and I think about Leo. There is something beautiful about your composition upstairs on Pier 92 right now, 123X, where this is this 30-foot plus expanse actually, and you described in the composition there are these speed lines running horizontally across, and then you hit this corner. And there is this black explosion, right? And so I don't want to overly narrativize that section, but for me, it seems like all of these elements of material have a direction. Like there is some kind of gravitational pull. Things are either moving toward or away from that. We don't know if it's the Big Bang and it's the beginning of the universe or the universe is imploding. But I do feel like there is a sense of expansion or contraction, but there's a directional movement in that piece. And I remember when you were installing it earlier this week and you're talking with your team, you know, and there's a point where some of the black lines were even moving in two horizontal line or two straight, and you're like, nope, we need to take that down. This needs to be, you know, the movement needs to be different. And I wonder if you can, in, you know, your own words, just talk about the energy in the piece as you see it.
Yeah, I'm sorry. So heavy. But I'll tell you, in the end, as I'm sort of working these things out, you sort of trust that as you're sort of laying this these parts down, that there are these different tonations, like music, mm-hmm. you know. And once you start, it's like you start with at this level, and from there it's like you can sort of mix in, you know, like your in betweens, your crashes and your screams and but also your whispers and your, you know, like your subtleties. I mean, all these things are absolutely necessary to sort of each one has its own identity. We're describing something that's here now, yep. But if I were to take those very same parts to another location and reconstruct, you know, something, you know, with those very same parts, you know, you would end up with a different identity.
Right.
You know, there was a lot of things going on as I was creating. I didn't come in here with a plan.
Right.
I came in with parts, mm-hmm. and just attacked the situation.
Yep.
But you'd be highly influenced by what's going on physically around you.
Yep.
And I allow that because that also assists in the piece becoming or having its own, you know, identity. Mm-hmm. Each time is in a different location.
Yep.
So you have to sort of not only realize the composition that's surrounding you, but also the things that are living around you at that moment. Mm-hmm. You guys are like putting up lights, putting right. down rugs.
Yep.
You know, the union guys screaming at and fighting at each other, you know.
Yep.
So I said, okay.
It was all happening.
Yeah, exactly. Then, yep. then the piece should be a part of that.
Yep. Yep.
Takes on that life, you know.
So if you were feeling like the tension or the frenetic energy leading up to mm-hmm. the opening of this fair and your installation is happening amid that, mm-hmm. you're not ignoring that. You're absorbing that.
Really.
And that's reflected.
Life is going on, right?
Yeah. Yeah.
Life is going on. Then you accept that as a real or mm-hmm. reality. Mm-hmm. And you bring it in.
Yep.
Why would you want to exclude that?
Right.
And it's also an opportunity, you know, to bring in something different. You know, I didn't know that I was going to come into that, you know. Mm-hmm. I wanted to get out of here after, immediately after, but
it was a very full day.
To take it in.
Yep.
You know?
Yep.
And I remember, Ian, when you came in, you were like, yeah, it's intense, you know. So like, yeah, it's intense in here, you know.
Yeah.
So I think that, you know, like, I think it's up to each artist to find his way when it comes to bringing these things to life.
Right.
But you use anything at your disposal to do that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I think that's actually a good moment to now, if we're able to open up to questions. I love the idea of letting the work reflect the real, the energy of the moment, and don't ignore that, respond to that, use that, harness that, mm-hmm. and then reflect it back. To us, and I see your films doing that, Chitavia. Of course, I see your piece upstairs doing that, Leo. But I want to give a moment for, it's a very unique opportunity, and we're privileged to have two artists here who've talked in response to each other about their practices. If anybody in the room wants to use this opportunity to ask a question, feel free. I know it's always hard to be the first in the room.
Well, you don't have to say anything.
You don't have to say anything.
It's all good.
Yes. Yes.
And that means they got it.
Yeah, I think so. I think so. And
you got one over here.
Yep.
Probably a lot better. Who what artists inspired you, I guess? Since you had stated before, you really didn't have...
Who are you talking to?
Both of you, actually.
Oh, okay.
But since you can start if you would like. No.
I'm inspired by Leonardo Drew. No, seriously. And they emailed me and they were like, you want to talk to Leonardo Drew? I was like, about what? Like, what am I going to say? Thank you for doing that, by the way. This is popping. Yep. I'm inspired by Charles Brunet's amazing filmmaker, Simone Lee. I'm inspired by Jack Whitten. I'm inspired by Howardina Pindell. Let's see, Arthur Jaffa is really dope. I'm inspired by Kathleen Collins. It's a really great black woman filmmaker. She is the first black woman to write, produce, direct a feature-length film. A lot of people think it's Daughters of the Dust, Julie Dash, but Daughters of the Dust actually was the first to get distributed. Kathleen was the first. She's an amazing filmmaker, amazing film called Losing Ground. I'm inspired by lots of people. Kevin Beasley is really great. It's hard. There's a very long list, but I really like installation and sculpture, and yep. I think that's really great. Hoping to maybe merge into that space later. Maybe Leonardo can school me.
All of what you said, I agree.
He agrees. There's a question up front from Chrissy.
He dittoed me.
Yes,
Leo said I did. Ditto. I agree.
Yeah. You were sleeping on that.
This is a question for Jatovia. I just wondered how your participation, having founded your participation in the New Negresses Film Society, influences your thinking about how you make your work. Because the collectivity of that amazing group of women filmmakers seems very important in relation mm-hmm. to what you're working on.
Yeah, it's pretty important, and you know, it came out of this impulse to create a space for ourselves after having gone to film school and feeling a little alienated in the space and by the programs and wanting to kind of make a space that was very central to the work that we were doing, but not just our five works, you know, the women who were there, but the work of other Black women filmmakers from across the, you know, the diaspora, so across the globe. So it was really important for us to kind of come together, and it felt like really like an emotional support space initially, and then it kind of emerged into this exhibition space. Actually, we started with exhibitions. One of the founding members, Kumi James, propositioned us. She said, you know, like, I think I want to, you know, screen my work and you guys should join me. And then we collectivized after that initial screening. So it was us attempting to create space for ourselves and our works that generally, you know, if we're talking about the film industry, they kind of go, you know, they get tossed to the side. There's not a ton of Black women film directors. You can name maybe two or three right now, but not a lot of people know more than a handful of Black directors, period. So we wanted to kind of stake our claim and say, you know, we are here, and this is the work that we're doing, and we're also going to make space for others. So we come together when we think about work, we workshop our works together, we critique work in private, things that we feel like we can't say in public about folks who have tons of money. But we think very critically about that work and about our own work. So it's really a support space, I feel like, more than anything, support an exhibition. Mm-hmm. The homies are here.
I guess I'll just ask one last question, and if there are any other lingering, just make sure you raise your hand before we finish up, and then we'll wrap up. But Chitavia, we had talked about the idea, this interest of film in an installation space, right? And I think it's hard. I would just love both of your impressions on, okay, here we are. There's this frenetic energy, you said, here on the piers. Right, in the art fair. If anybody tried to get up or downstairs today, they know what you're talking about, or in the lines to come in and out. And to make room and space to take something in over time. You've clearly put a lot of time into your work, or sometimes it's, you know, months and months of rusting something and then gathering these materials and bringing something back over years and bringing it back in, or putting something on the shelf and bringing it forward. How do you view work, and how do you make space to give it time? And what would you advise people if they're trying to look? It's hard. It's hard to, like, we haven't cracked that nut on letting film be the site-responsive installation that somebody would give time, and it wouldn't be lost in the fray. So, like, how do we create that space of looking, or how do you just do it for yourself?
How do I create space to create, is what we're saying. Is that, that's the question, right?
Create space to create so that you still see, you don't get numb.
Boy, I'm almost working around the clock, you know, and it's just push this thing out of the way so you can have space, and then you start working in that corner. I get filled up, push this out of the way. So it's the sheer physical of actually lifting and putting this over there so that I have space. It doesn't matter the size of the space. In San Antonio, I had 20,000 square feet of space. In the end, you know, it gets filled up with a bunch of stuff. And you have to, you know, then physically, you know, move this, you know, over here so that you can have space over there, you know.
So you're talking about that physical, the handwork, it's kind of coming back to the quote that I was saying to you. Get away from the digital. Mm-hmm. You get back into this realm of the tactile, the material, the physical. And you have then, I guess it's when people say they, you know, they're in the zone. Or there, you know, you can get into a space where you can tune everything else out. Mm-hmm. What about you, Chitavia?
As someone whose work, like when I make my work, I don't initially think about putting it in a gallery or a museum space, and it was a great surprise to me to have it be exhibited in, you know, these amazing spaces that I hadn't conceived of them. Shout out to Chrissy Isles, Rujeko Hockley, folks at the Whitney. Yeah, I initially think about having my space on a big screen, you know, having my work on a large screen. So when we are bringing it into these white cubes, these boxes, I am hoping, you know, I'm really clamoring for them to make the space discreet, you know, to intimate a cinema almost. And if we can't do that, then the sound at least has to be playing. I feel like the folks who have done, you know, Trigger, that the show at New Museum, the way that the videos were shown there were incredible. You know, you had one
Johanna Burton.
Yeah, the curator. Shout them out. Yeah, you had them. You know, a whole screen slicing down the middle of a room. You have another room where a screen is leaned catty corner, and it's just it's taking up the entire space. So I hope that folks who are not to tell curators how to do their jobs, but it would be thoughtful and awesome if we could, if the video works are not. If they are supposed to take up a lot of space, if they were conceived as a work that does that, that they be allowed to do that, you know, that they be allowed to have some room. But yeah, I'm really excited about moving into an installation mind frame, or you know, to think about the work in that way. I've been making a feature for the past several years, but I'm hoping, you know, in addition to that, to really kind of conceive of some site-specific type of work that incorporates the digital and both the analog animations and montages.
Well, you heard it here first. So thank you both for your expansive works and for letting us occupy your spaces, and really grateful to talk with you today.